It is now my privilege to introduce our featured speaker for the evening, Mr. Michael Reagan. Michael Reagan is the eldest son of former President Ronald Reagan and Academy Award-winning actress Jane Wyman. His commitments to public service and the vision his father championed are second to none, making him the natural heir to the Reagan legacy. Michael spent nearly three decades as a conservative talk radio host, heard across the country daily on a show syndicated by premier radio networks. He left this position to travel the country in order to champion President Ronald Reagan's values and principles in the public policy forum. He has also appeared for years on network television as a commentator and guest on the Today Show, Good Morning America, Fox News, and more, and is a Newsmax TV contributor. He has also authored numerous books. Michael also serves as chairman and president of the Reagan Legacy Foundation, which seeks to advance the causes President Reagan held dear and to memorialize the accomplishments of his presidency. Michael is also involved in charities and public service, including Young America's Foundation, and is on the advisory board for Mixed Roots Foundation, which helps the adopter and foster care community. Michael is a man who has done everything from debating Mikhail Gorbachev to setting world records in powerboat racing. His racing raised more than $1.5 million for charities like the United States Olympic Team, Cystic Fibrosis, the Juvenile Diabetes Foundation, and Statue of Liberty Restoration Fund. Michael is married to Colleen, and they have two children, Ashley and Cameron. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Michael Reagan.
Yeah, if you see me walk around, that's what years of powerboat racing will do to you at 100 miles an hour in a 40-foot scarab boat in the ocean. But I wouldn't have given up for anything. It's great to have you all here. What, 130 of you here? I thought as you were all coming up and introducing yourselves, I could never do that at home and say, I want to speak to like-minded people because I have Patty and Ron at the house. And Patty and Ron weren't really like-minded. And so if this weekend you find someone in your group that isn't like-minded like you all, and they're not going to vote the way you're going to vote, you do what my sister Maureen and I always did the night before an election. We flipped a coin to see who was going to cancel which vote of which of the other children. So we do that. We did that for many, many years. And when I was your age, and well, 21 years old, we didn't have a Young America's group, YAF group, to be able to go to and learn about conservatism and all those kinds of things. And what I was thinking about, really, at 21 years of age, I wasn't thinking about Young America's Foundation. I was thinking it'd be really cool if my dad became governor, because it'd be a great way to find dates. And there's not a guy in this room who would not agree with me. And so that's what I was thinking about at 21 years of age, was the first time I could vote, as for my father. There is a young lady in here from Omaha. I just got back from Omaha. My wife's family's from there. She escaped when she was like 21 years old and came to California, and I found her. And we were back there for a week, and your father wanted a photograph of you with me. If you'll step up here, we can get that done right away, if you want to kind of come on up. I was in Norfolk, I was in Atkinson, I was in Omaha. I asked for chicken tonight because if you go to Nebraska, all they eat is steak. And I put on some pounds. Where are you?
I'm from Kansas.
Oh, you're coming? Where is she? Coming up. We get the photograph. So it's really great to be here and to see all you young people again and what have you. And I sent out a tweet today. If you ever follow me on Twitter, it's at Reagan World. And one of the tweets I sent out today, because I'm really kind of beside myself with what's going on in Washington, and the tweet simply was this: you can tell none of the people in charge in Washington ever attended a YAF conference, because had they done that, they would not be playing the games that they're playing. They would be able to find a leader. And so you are that generation that may have to find the next leader, conservative leader, in the world that you live in, because we have left you $33 trillion in debt. That's what my generation has been able to do. Your job is to stop that slide into more and more debt. And what I like to always tell young people when I'm here is they always ask about my father. How was he so knowledgeable about so many issues? Because he read everything. And so you're going to hear from a lot of speakers this weekend, which is great. They're all great speakers and what have you. But get their books, read the information, but also read history so you understand how we got to where we are. To read where we are today is one thing, but you'll never fix the issue or fix the problem if you don't understand where it all started. I'll give you an example. The debt, $33 trillion in debt. Where did it start? What most people don't talk about or want to talk about is back in 1972, takes back a few years, we had another president. And the other president was getting all involved in Watergate, Richard Nixon. Up until 1972, the President of the United States had the authority to impound money from Congress and not spend it if he thought it would bust the budget. And because Richard Nixon was in such trouble with Watergate, the Congress decided to use that weakness with Richard Nixon to take that authority away from the President of the United States and give it 100% to the Congress of the United States. So basically in 1973, 74, the Congress now had all the authority, the President had none. In fact, the President could be taken to court by Congress for being in contempt of Congress if he did not spend every single dollar allocated by the Congress of the United States. My father was threatened twice by Congress not spending the money. So unless you fix that problem, goes back to 1972, you're not going to fix the problem today. Because the Congress of the United States, and how often do you hear people say, hey, why don't they do it like we do it at home? Why don't they put money aside? Because by law, the President of the United States has to spend every dollar allocated by the Congress of the United States. If not, they go to court. And that's what bothers me sometimes when I'm hearing members of Congress, presidential candidates, or what have you, go out and talk about what they would do if they're elected, with not talking about where the problem started. Another issue they talk about, let's have term limits for Congress. That's a great idea. Now, you could do that in your city or in your state, but in 1969, the Supreme Court said, you can't do that at the national level. So there's already been a court order on that you cannot have term limits on a congressman or a senator that's elected and goes back to Washington, D.C. So it's a great applause line, but it doesn't go anywhere. And that's what bothers me sometimes when I listen to these things, because I learned so much from my father. In fact, I learned about America, not from Young America's Foundation like you're going to learn. I learned about it riding out to another ranch. See, this is the third ranch my father ever had. And I grew up on the other two. Yes, I went up to this one, but I grew up on one in Malibu, California, and in Tarzana, California. And we go out there every Saturday, little boy. My dad would pick me up from my mom's house, and we ride out there. And for the ride out to the ranch, he would regale me with stories of America. He would sing to me the songs of all the different organizations, the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps, the Coast Guard. And he would tell me the stories. And I learned about America sitting in the right front seat of a car listening to my father on any given Saturday morning. And it was amazing that time I got to spend with my father listening to those stories. And I would listen to him, and maybe as a young boy, I would ask him to shut up because I was doing something else. But you don't realize what you learn until you get older. And all of a sudden you realize, okay, he was telling me something. He wanted me to remember something. And I remembered so much of it. And I enjoyed so much of it back then. But I enjoyed it more now, looking at the world that we live in, and young people like yourselves coming into it, trying to learn about America, and you have social media, all these other things coming in and attacking you every single day. And you don't have that time to sit down, that quiet time that you need sometimes to spend with a loved one or a friend and really talk about the issues of the day. And I hear you all up here saying you want to meet like-minded people, and you're going to meet like-minded people. But the biggest thing is to listen. My father was a great listener, and as I said, a great reader of everything. Readers are leaders. If you're not reading, you're not leading. And that's why he was such a great leader, because he did read, he did lead, and he listened. People always say, well, what college did your father go to? I said, well, he went to Eureka College. Now think about this. So many people want to go to Harvard. They want to go to Southern Cal. They want to go to this college, that college. And I imagine one day back in Washington, D.C., there's a real problem going on in the world. And all these guys are standing around Ronald Reagan. And they're saying, what should we do? This guy's from Harvard. This guy's from Princeton. This guy's from Southern Cal. And what happened, that's all going to change. You're going to have to compromise. And you may not get everything you want. My father had 80-20 rule. If you're with me 80% of the time, I'm okay with your 20. But today, we're going to the 100% rule. If you're not with me 100% of the time, then I'm not going to talk to you at all. You can't do that and make friends and get things done. My dad helped pass the largest tax break in American history back in the early 80s, working with Tip O'Neill, who was the head of the House at the time. You have Newt Gingrich working with Bill Clinton back in the 1990s. The last time we had a balanced budget in America was when Bill Clinton was president of the United States and Newt Gingrich was Speaker of the House. That wouldn't happen today in America because you have too much noise. And the too much noise is drowning out the people who are trying to think straight and get things done. Too many people are trying to get on TV or be on radio so they can raise money for this issue or that issue. And we need to really get away from that, step back. As I say to some people and people say to me, we need to get back to Reagan and who he was and what he was. You have a lot of people that will talk about Ronald Reagan, but tomorrow you're going to do something they've never done. You're going to walk in the footsteps of Ronald Reagan. More of our leaders need to be in the footsteps of Ronald Reagan, going through that house. Look at the humility and the humbleness of Ronald Reagan, who he was. Not enough have done that. They talk about my dad, they lift him up, but when they start making decisions, they're off the page. And that disappoints me, and it's not good for you or anybody in America. Just like what's going on now back in Washington, D.C. You can't have this issue. We are right now in America, we are prime for conservatives to take over. And we have a House of Representatives that doesn't know how to do that. Can't elect a leader. Can't put anybody in charge. And the Democrats are sitting in Washington, D.C. laughing and smirking while we Republicans try to figure out what we're going to do, where we're going to go, who's going to lead. We have two wars going on. Third wars in Congress. Two wars. As my father said, no war. He lived during a time where there were four wars. None of them were started because America was too strong. America only sees war when America is weak. And when America is weak, the world is weak. The world looks at America for leadership. After my father passed, the next morning I was having breakfast with Lady Thatcher at the hotel. I didn't know she was there. We just ran into each other coming down for breakfast. And she said, oh, Michael, think of the world would have been better had your dad been elected in 1976. I said, Lady Thatcher, had he been elected in 1976, the Cold War would still be raging, Berlin Wall would still be up. She said, why would you say that? I said, in 1976, Lady Thatcher, where were you? Where was Pope John Paul? Where was Lech Walesa? Where was Vaclav Havel? Where was Mikhail Gorbachev? None of you were in place in 1976. Had Dad been reelected, he would have been out in 1985, which is the year Mikhail Gorbachev comes into power in the Soviet Union. I said, I believe God picks his moment, picks his people, picks his time. In 1980, when he's elected, all of you were in place. And you had an American president, a strong American president, who could go out and bring everybody together towards one goal, bringing down that Berlin Wall, first of all through Poland, bringing peace to Poland and around the globe. We don't have that cadre of leaders in the world we live in today. No matter where you go, it's hard to find that person to stand up and take charge. There's no adult in the room taking charge. And hopefully the adult is in this room that's going to ultimately take charge at some point with the knowledge you will gain this weekend as you listen to the speakers and go up and see my father's ranch and deal with all of those things. But the world is missing that adult. When Ronald Reagan died, the adult in the room died. And I think every day that goes by, every year that goes by, more and more people are starting to really understand the importance of who he was at the time that he served as President of the United States of America. We were all very lucky to have him. It was a great time for all of us. Unfortunately, your generation never saw it. You read about it maybe, you hear about it from your parents or grandparents, but you never got to see it. What you need to do this weekend is learn what it was and how to get back there. How do we get back there? How do we take that and bring it forward? How can I, this weekend, collective I from all of you, how do I move it forward on my high school campus and in my college campus? We see what's going on in the college campuses. You see they're out there for what? For Hamas, a terrorist organization? We have members of Congress that basically support a terrorist organization. And one of the major problems we have there is America is the only country in the world that allows the enemies of the United States to move in, buy a home, settle in, and live in America. And then they infiltrate our system, our politics, and our educational system. And they tear it apart. And they start teaching kids, young people like you, to hate America instead of the reasons to love America. And we, in order to win again, have to start loving America again. Right now we don't, but we have to learn how to love America, because unless we do, we will not win another election. You win it through loving America, not hating America. So find the people that love it. Find the people who want to stand up for it and be with those people and learn from them. You can also learn from the people you disagree with. My father and Patty and Ron didn't get along politically. My sister Marie and I didn't get along politically with Patty and Ron. But you know something? My dad never kicked them away from the dinner table. They were always at the dinner table. There for Thanksgiving, which we had at the ranch every year, or whether it was Christmas when we got together as a family. They weren't kicked away from the table. You can't kick people away from the table all the time and expect you're going to keep on winning. You hear a lot about rhinos. Rhino Republicans. Rhino Republicans helped elect Ronald Reagan. Without the Rhino Republicans, we're not a big enough group. Conservatives are the smaller group of people within a party. We're not the larger group, we're the smaller group. The Republican Party is the minority party. You can't spend your whole day kicking people out and then wonder why you're losing. It's pretty simple. You've got to have a message. You've got to have a leader that you're going to follow. And if you have the right message and the right leader, then you're going to go on and do the things my father did. One person called me the other day and said, "Do you know what Donald Trump said?" I said, "No, what Donald Trump said?" He said he had more support than Ronald Reagan ever had. And I said, "Have him call me when he wins 49 states. My dad won 49 states. You don't win 49 states with just Republicans. You have to get independents, like-minded Democrats. You have to bring people together. And you don't do it by yelling and screaming. You do it by having a great message that's going to go across party lines and reach out and touch other people. My dad and I didn't realize till later on the great relationship we had, the places he would put me when important things were happening. I look at what's going on in the world today and I can tell you, this crap would not be happening if Ronald Reagan were President of the United States of America. Russia never would have gone into the Ukraine, ever. What's going on right now in Israel would not be going on because you had a strong president, a strong leader. I remember one time I was having dinner with my dad, and he got a call from Ed Meese, who worked with my dad, chief of staff. And he said, "Mr. President, you know we're doing war games in the Gulf of Sidra." My dad said, "Yes, I know, Ed. I, I approved it. Jimmy Carter had canceled it. He said, well, I have the admiral of the aircraft carrier on the phone. He needs to ask you a question. Well, what is it, Ed? He says, well, seems Muammar Gaddafi is sending planes out, and they're locking on to our boys, and there's fear that one of Gaddafi's planes may shoot at one of our boys. And the admiral wants to know, what should we do if we're shot at? My dad said, shoot back. Next question comes, says, well, Mr. President, what happens if we're shot at and they turn and they run? My dad said, well, you chase them. And then the next question was, well, Mr. President, what happens if they shoot at us and they turn and run back into their own airspace? And my dad said, Ed, if they shoot at us, you chase them all the way back to their hangars if necessary, but you will shoot them down. Yes, Mr. President. My dad went to bed with Nancy, and my wife, Colleen, and I left the hotel, went back to our house. The next morning, the world woke up to two Russian MiGs in the ground off the Gulf of Sidra. And the media couldn't believe that Ed Meese didn't call my dad in the morning to tell him what had happened, because my dad just kept on saying, we made that decision before I went to bed. But he made those kinds of decisions, and he made them all the time. And in order to lead, you've got to make decisions sometimes in that kind of a moment to protect the United States of America, protect your citizens, protect our military, and what have you. And that's exactly what my father did. And to be there in those moments and those times, I tell the story up here a lot too about how I found out about the tax system in America, riding out to the ranch with my dad. And my dad was cheap. So was my mother. Both Midwestern kids. You know, I had a dollar a week allowance is what I got. And I thought that was pretty cheap for growing up in Beverly Hills, couldn't afford it. And I asked my dad for a larger allowance, and my dad told me for the next 10, 15 minutes, told me about the tax system in America. I just wanted to know, you could give me a larger allowance? I'm 8 years old. I don't care. Just, I need more money. And so I heard about it. He said, well, you know, the government takes 90 cents out of every dollar I make. And with that 10 cents that's left, I take care of your mother, yourself, your sister Maureen, my new wife Nancy, our new daughter Patty, the ranch we're driving into, the cows and the horses and the foreman. Now I'm doing the math in my little eight-year-old head. And as we arrived inside the ranch that day, I offered him back half my allowance. I felt so sorry for him. And he said, no, but when the president's elected gives me a tax break, I'll give you a larger allowance. I said, well, that's cool. I didn't know Democrat from Republican, but I knew more money from less. And when Kennedy was elected in 1960, Kennedy took the tax system from 90% to 70. So my dad got that tax break, and he raised me from $1 to $5. If you do the math, I was in high school. But he remembered what he told me. That's another thing you can learn from Ronald Reagan. If he told you something, you could take it to the bank. Take it to the bank. When he told the air traffic controllers his first year in office that if you go on strike, you're fired, and they went on strike and they were fired. That sent a message across the globe to people he would be negotiating with at another time. So also understand this, that when you're speaking and talking to people, talking to a group, other people are listening. You're at this table talking about an issue, but that table there might be listening in on the issue. And they may react to what you're saying. So my dad knew if I fire these guys, that's going to be a shot heard around the world. So when I'm negotiating with Mikhail Gorbachev later on in my life, and I tell him, you're going to do what I want you to do, or I'm going to bankrupt you, Mikhail Gorbachev has a sense to believe it, which is exactly what was going to happen if Mikhail Gorbachev didn't come on board. So understand that. People will talk about my father when he became president of the United States on that fateful day, wonderful day, and the hostages all went free. And everybody says, what a great job. They came home because of Ronald Reagan, he would have, whatever. But if you go back and you listen to back then what they were saying about my father, it's no different than what they're saying today. It's how you respond to what's being said about you. And today we respond completely different than the way Ronald Reagan responded. Ronald Reagan responded with a wink and a nod and a smile. Today we flip people off, yell and scream at them, and nothing gets accomplished. But if you go back and check out 1980 campaign, what you'll hear is, he's a racist, he's a warmonger, you elect him, he will start World War III. But you'll never hear Ronald Reagan ever deny what was being said about him, because he understood those people on the other side were listening to every word that's being said about him. And so he allowed the left to sell those people who are holding our men and women hostage, he allowed the left to sell them what he might do when he's elected president of the United States and sworn in. And because the left did such a great job of selling that to the evil people, and those people, evil and, you know, people who were not for freedom, did such a great job. When my dad is sworn in, what happens? The hostages go free. But what does Ronald Reagan do then? He turns to Jimmy Carter on that day, and he says to Jimmy Carter, you know, you worked your tail off to bring these kids home. You take Air Force One. You've earned the right to take Air Force One, and you fly to Germany, and you bring the hostages home. Wouldn't happen today. And one of the reasons these things don't happen today is too many people in Washington are trying to take credit instead of give credit. And if you look at the placards on my dad's desk, you probably have the placards here. No telling what you could do, what you can accomplish if you don't worry who gets the credit. So as you're putting together these YAF groups on your campus, don't pat yourself on the back. Don't sit there and take the credit and say it's about me, because that's where you lose. Listen to a Ronald Reagan speech. You'll never hear the word I. It's always we, working together, this country. And so start using we, not I. Start giving credit, not taking credit. And we started doing things of that nature, we'd be a lot better off than we are today. And your generation has its chance to start it all over again. Your generation has a chance this weekend to learn. And when you learn, read. When you read history, understand where the problem started, fix the problems, move forward, because someday you're going to be in my position, and you don't want to say to the next group of YAF coming in 40 years from now, oh, by the way, now you're $100 trillion in debt. You want to get out of debt. You want to have an America that doesn't talk about race all the time to try and win elections, but talks about each other and working together to move forward. That's what you're going to have to do this weekend. Get to know the people at your table, get to know the people at other tables. You might be comfortable because you're all from Canada. You might be comfortable because you're all from, well, there's only one from Omaha. Hope you get comfortable. But if you have to sometimes break away from your comfort zone to make a difference. So meet the others from the other groups, the other schools, and get to know them. Because you will learn more from those people sometimes than you learn at the table you're at, because you're comfortable with the people you've been with and you came here with. Learn from those people. Move forward. Ronald Reagan was a great man, great president, great father. I'm one of the luckiest guys in the world. I was adopted into the Reagan family. By the way, the best thing they ever did. I've met the other kids. They should have started, right? I should have been first. But seriously, learn this weekend from your tables, other tables, from the people that are going to speak to you, and listen, ask great questions, get great answers, and then leave and take it with you. But take Ronald Reagan with you and open up a YAF, but take it under the guise of Ronald Reagan, who he was, not who we are today. Thank you. Now,
we have time for a brief Q&A, so if you want to come stand over here or line up with Allie in the back, remember to state your name and where you go to school before asking your brief question.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I go to Buchanan High School, and my question is, obviously Ronald Reagan was a great leader and we want to be a great leader like him, but everyone also has their own individual leadership style, so how can we sort of combine those two concepts?
Say, what's the second part again?
But obviously everyone has their own leadership style that suits them, how do we really combine those two concepts?
I think the best concept you can have and what you're going to see tomorrow is the ranch, humility. You can combine that through humility, being humble. Ronald Reagan, if anything, was humble. And have a great sense of humor. Be able to laugh when people say things about you. Just laugh, wink and a nod. But be humble. And seriously, when you go to that home tomorrow, the ranch, you're going to see humility squared. And especially when you walk into their bedroom and you see the beds together. Look at how they're put together and look at what's at the end of my father's side of the bed. Talk about humility. I would never be that way, but he was. But he lived what he said, and he believed what he said, and he took it to the fullest. So humility, humble.
Hi, I'm Michael. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland. Both my parents were immigrants from the Soviet Union, and your dad obviously had a lot to do with the process of eventually them, you know, getting over here to the United States. Mm-hmm. And I'm curious as to what your personal relationship was with Mikhail Gorbachev.
Interesting. Yeah. My dad basically, they became friends to an extent. You know, Mikhail Gorbachev was at the ranch. I was there the day he was at the ranch, wore his hat backwards all day. Nobody wanted to tell me his hat on backwards, the cowboy hat. One of the funniest parts was the blue Jeep. Have you seen the blue Jeep upstairs? Dad goes and grabs a blue Jeep, pulls it up, tells Mikhail Gorbachev, get in, I'll take you for a ride. And the Secret Service and like went, oh my God, and started chasing the blue Jeep. Yeah, you can't, Mr. President, you can't drive the president. You can't drive him. You're not allowed to drive. But my relationship with it really was good. My wife, Colleen, and his daughter, who ran his organization there in Moscow, also used to giggle and laugh at the events. But I found out things about Mikhail Gorbachev. He said to me, he never said to anybody else who interviewed him. I talked to him about my dad and Christianity and what have you. And I said to him, I said, every time my father and you sat down, my father ended every meeting with saying, if it's God's will. And he answered that and said, well, I never saw God in the room. And I was up in San Francisco area, and everybody in there applauded. But he was even taken aback by the applause in San Francisco when he would say, I didn't see God in the room. And I took him a little bit farther. I said, tell me about your family. Tell me about Raisa. Tell me about her parents. Raisa, his wife, her grandparents were killed by the Gestapo for having Christian artifacts in their home. They were hidden behind, or no, actually out front, and they were killed. Mikhail Gorbachev's family also had Christian artifacts hidden behind pictures of Lenin and Stalin. So they never knew. Something else nobody knew. Mikhail Gorbachev's grandmother was a Christian. And she would go to church every day. And she'd go back up to the Kremlin, knock on the door to see Mikhail and say, Mikhail, I went to church today. I prayed for atheists. I prayed for you. Nobody else had ever gotten that story from Mikhail Gorbachev. And it really bonded us, and a couple of my dad's writers were in the room, literally fell out of their chairs because they had never gotten the information either. So our relationship was very cordial, very nice, and we laughed and we giggled, and his interpreter was with him forever. I'm glad I got to know him. I was very lucky to be in that kind of a position to ask those kinds of questions and for him to an extent, befriend me, and when he would be somewhere, he would ask that, can Mike Reagan come, and his wife, and so we would go and be with him and with his daughter. So it was very good.
Thank you.
Now.
Hi, my name's Emma Leach. I'm homeschooled with Seton Home Study. So my question was, you were saying that if we wanna be good leaders, we need to read a lot. So I was wondering, what are some good authors and books that you'd recommend for me?
Well, you know, the library here is full. I was talking to down here? So he said, what's really a good book you like? I love God and Ronald Reagan. It is a phenomenal book. Because it's not, so many of the books are written on the political side, and this really isn't so much that political side. But God and Ronald Reagan is a great book. There's another book there, Lessons My Father Taught Me, written by Michael Reagan. Great book. I understand it's his son, wrote a great book, yeah, Lessons My Father Taught Me. You learn those lessons as you get older, in fact, in life. But that'd be a good one, but there's some great books back there by some really great authors. And Andrew and anybody here can just point you in a direction. My favorite's God and Ronald Reagan. That's my favorite. Other than that, I read Jack Carr novels, who's a sniper.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Michael, it's great to see you. My name is Ryan, and my question was, what is the most important life lesson to you that you've received from your father?
Forgiveness. Best life lesson. If I had not learned to forgive, I'd be in a tent on a sidewalk with a cup. True. I think we all of us go through things in our life. I've gone through things in my life. When I was a young boy, I was in boarding school and after school daycare type situation because my parents were actors and what have you. I was sexually abused from the time I was 8 years old to 9. I was made part of child pornography at 9 years old. And I was made to develop the photograph by my molester. And when I was 9 years old, I walked away from God, walked away from my father, walked away from my mother, walked away from life, walked away from the church. And it wasn't until I married Colleen, God, it'd be 48 years ago, November 7th, where she taught me to run back to God instead of away from God. But I had to learn to forgive myself for the way I had treated people all those many years because of the pain I was feeling. I was treating other people to try and make them hurt as much as I was hurting. I think when I finally told my dad about it on April 12th, 1987, fourth birthday of our daughter Ashley, I think he wrote in his diary that day, Mike's back, because I'd been gone for so long. Even though I was paying attention, I was around. I didn't want to be successful. I didn't really want to do anything. I was worried about the photographs coming out. And I considered suicide as an option. So I was going through a lot of stuff. So I had to learn to forgive. When he forgave John Hinckley in 1981 for trying to kill him, I said, if he could forgive a man who tried to kill him, I certainly can forgive myself and all the other things, ancillary things around it. And that's where I started to grow again. And within my family, my wife, my children, and what have you. And just carry that a little bit further. When my dad shot March 30th, 1981, here's my dad. I guess I can tell two stories out of this. One, I would see him at 10 o'clock the next morning in Washington, D.C. at the hospital. And I'll show you, this is my dad, walking at 10 o'clock in the morning, 6 hours after he's off the table. And I said, good morning, Dad. I'm with my family, my wife, and just my wife, Cameron, stayed home. And my dad looked at me and said, Will, you know, yesterday I was shot. And I said, yes, Dad, the world knows you were shot yesterday. Will, if you're ever going to get shot, don't be wearing a new suit. I said, why are you telling me this? Well, the first time I'd worn that suit, I just put it on that morning, bought it the day before, got it ready for me. He said, young man who shot me, Hinckley. I said, yes, John Hinckley. Well, I understand his parents live in Denver. Yeah, they do, Dad. Well, do you think they have any money? I said, well, they live in Denver and in the oil business. I'm sure they have money. Well, do you think they'd ever buy me a new suit? 6 hours after he's off the table. But a few months after my dad is shot, Pope John Paul is also shot. Both Pope John Paul, and my father did what before they went back to the Vatican and the White House? Both of them, imagine if I asked people in this room right now, how many can recite the Lord's Prayer, I would say most hands, and not all hands, would go up. But the next question would be, how many of you live the Lord's Prayer? Because that's a heck of a lot different than just reciting it. And those two people lived it. Why? Because both of them forgave their detractors, those who tried to murder them, before they both went back to work, and formed a bond that ultimately brought down the Berlin Wall with the help of Lady Thatcher and others. But if there was not the bond of Pope John Paul and Ronald Reagan, all the other dominoes never would have happened. So forgiveness is the number one thing, and I say that in my book, last chapter, forgiveness. If you don't learn to forgive, you'll never be a success.
Hi, my name is Lucy Hickey. I'm from San Francisco, California. My question for you is, what characteristics or virtues besides humility, of course, should a good leader cultivate, and what should we focus on specifically as young citizens to be great leaders for our country now and in the future?
You're really close to the microphone, so if somebody just real quick tell me. You're really so close to it, it's like muffled to me.
Sorry. Basically, my question is, what characteristics besides humility should a good leader cultivate, specifically us as young citizens, so we can be good?
Learn to be a leader. That's what you're here for this weekend. Learn to lead. You know, you lead from the front. Learn to lead from the front. But have a message that people will want to follow you. What you need to do this weekend is really listen to those who are speaking and really listen to them, because every one of them has a message. Every one of them has a message. You're here to hear speakers. Why? Because you probably heard them before, read about them. So they have a message. They have a message they're trying to talk to you about. They're leaders within their own society. So you need to find your message. Let me tell you, I sat there, just told you the stuff I went through as a child. When I started talk radio almost 30 years, when I started talk radio, I just knew everybody loved Ronald Reagan. So every answer I had was wrapped back to Ronald Reagan. So I felt people would love Ronald Reagan enough that it would brush off and they would love me. So if you love Ronald Reagan, you'll love me. And then somebody called my radio show one day, you know, hi, long time listener, first time caller. And he said to me, he said, you know, I've been listening to you a long time. But you keep on giving answers that sound more like your father. What do you believe in? And this is a question each one of you can look in your own mirror and ask yourself. And I realized when he asked me that question, I had no idea what I believed in. I believed in, if I make you happy with my dad, you'll love me. I had to go, why? I didn't know why I was pro-life. I was pro-life because my dad was pro-life. I was pro-gun because my dad was pro-gun. I was pro this because my dad was this. I was anti that because my dad was this. I didn't know why I was all those things, except that the way I got everywhere. I'm sure you all raised in the families you're raised in, your parents have, you know, ideals and ideas and how they feel about different issues. But you're not going to go anywhere if you're going to live completely off what your parents are saying. You got to find that way. You got to find your own road. Why am I here? Why am I there? I had a son, Cameron, off the rails when he was younger, stuff like that. You know, today he's got three kids. He's got two little girls, 7 and 5-year-old, and a little boy named Gage. You know what I nicknamed our grandson Gage? 12. I can't wait till his first day of school. What's your name? My name's Gage Reagan, but you can call me 12. You know, but Cameron today, like I tell him, if he wasn't my son, I'd want to be his. Because he's got so much knowledge. And he's gained that on his own, not through me. He's got his own. I keep on telling him, get your own talk show. Just get out of here. Quit bothering me every day. But again, those are just some ideas, what you can do, what you need to do. You need to find out why you believe it other than dad does or mom does. I believe it because. Because if you don't, you'll lose every argument you're ever in. You can't call mom and dad. You can't call a friend. Like the television show does. You can't do that because you say, well, yeah. That make sense to you?
This will be our last question.
No.
Hi, Mr.
Barry Reagan. Barry gets to answer this one.
I'm McKenna Harrison. I go to Libertas Prep in Santa Clarita, California. My question to you is, how do you suggest and in what ways can we bring people together when we seem to disagree at the most basic level?
You know, as I said, you know, I sat with brothers and sisters, we disagree at every basic level. But you sit down, you still can break bread together. To find something you can do together. You don't have to make everything about politics. I mean, you have members of your family who disagree with you. You don't have to start every conversation with, I believe in this, I believe in Trump, I don't believe in Trump, I do this. Find things you agree on. There's always something you agree on. You don't have to make every meal an argument. Every time you get together, an argument. By now, the people you're probably talking about already know how you feel. You don't have to sit there and tell them again. You know, just find ways. This weekend, I'm back in Nebraska. And, you know, there's one family member of Colleen's who's diehard liberal. You know, we talked about everything else. We didn't talk about politics. How's the family? How's everything going? You know, be nice. Sometimes you kill them with kindness. Or like Dad said in one debate, I'm not going to make your youth and experience any big deal. And he won the debate. Not by arguing, by saying something that made everybody chuckle and laugh. So sometimes you got to learn to chuckle and laugh and not, don't laugh, don't, here's what my wife said to me, this is back years ago, which also helped me get through everything. She said, don't let someone else's attitude determine your attitude for the remainder of your day. And too often we allow other people to determine our attitude for the whole day. And that, you cannot allow that to happen. Grin and bear it. My dad could sit there and say, hey, will they buy me a new suit after he's got a bullet wound in him? I'm sure we can find a way to do likewise.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Mr. Reagan.
That it? Shall you stay here till next week?
Absolutely.
Thank you all so very, very much. Appreciate it. You have a great weekend. Love the ranch. I know you will. You will hear. I don't know what your thoughts are about Ronald Reagan. I don't know if your parents have been to the ranch or what have you. But what I find with most people who go out to the ranch who have never been there before, all the things you thought about Ronald Reagan will hit you in the face when you open the door and walk into that house. You'll go, oh my God, I was right. He was exactly who I believed he was. And you know something? He was. Thank you very much.